Hello, everyone. I'm Mohammed Tavakkoli, and as the director of Elahé Mir-Djalali Institute of Iranian Studies, I welcome you to our weekly webinar series. In addition to York University Department of History and Ryerson Department of English, our series is sponsored by the Department of History, Department of Historical Studies, Near and Middle Eastern Civilizations, Women, Gender and Sexuality Studies, UTM, the Cinema Institute, and the Center for Comparative Literature. It is also sponsored by Critical Studies in Equity and Solidarity at the University of Toronto. I am grateful for the critical support of all sponsoring academic units. I'm also thankful to colleagues, Professor Shahzad Mojab, Victoria Tahmaspi, Leila Purtawaf, Nima Naqibi, Gulberg Rekab Talayi, Sara Saljuqi, Azita Talaghani, Mahdiye Valizadeh, Jairan Gahan, Reza Tahir-Kirmani, Arshavez Muzaffari, and Khatir Shaibani for their invaluable support of women poets and Iranian cinema projects. I also like to express our collective gratitude to Canada's Indigenous people and acknowledge this land on which the University of Toronto operates. For thousands of years, it has been the traditional land of the Huron, Wendat, the Seneca, and most recently, the Mississaugas of Credit River. Today, this meeting place is still the home of many Indigenous people from across Turtle Island, and we are grateful to have the opportunity to work and prosper on their land. It is a great pleasure to welcome Professor Sunil Sharma, our speaker for today, to the University of Toronto. My colleague and collaborator, Professor Azita Talaghani, will introduce Professor Sharma and moderate today's session. Professor Talaghani.
Thank you, Mohammed. Thank you so much. Welcome, everybody, to Iranian Studies webinar series of women poets. It's great honor and pleasure. Today, I introduce Dr. Sunil Sharma, who is a professor of Persianate and comparative literature in Boston University. Professor Sharma's areas of expertise are Persian and South Asian literatures. His research interests include poetry and court cultures, history of the book, translation, and travel writing. He has translated prose and poetry from classical and modern Persian, Tajik, Urdu, and Hindi. His translations of the medieval Persian poet Amir Khosrow's lyric and narrative poems appeared in the Bazaar of Love, published by Penguin in 2010. The translation of an early Urdu travelogue was published in Atiye's Journey, a Muslim Women from Colonial Bombay to Edwardian Britain, published by Oxford University Press in 2011. A forthcoming volume, the result of a multi-year project entitled Veiled Voyagers, Muslim Women Travelers from Asia and Middle East, with Siobhan Lambert Hurley from Sheffield University and Dalian Majkrovich from Northwestern University, will be in the form of an anthology of around 40 Muslim women's travel pieces translated into English from a range of languages, including Persian and Urdu. His latest book, Mughal Arcadia, Persian Poetry in an Indian Court, which is published by Harvard University Press in 2017, is a study of early modern Persianate literature. The title of Professor Sharma's today's talk is Anthologies of Persian or Persianate Poetry by Women. Please join me, welcome Professor Sharma to our webinar series.
Thank you, Professor Talaghani, for the kind introduction, and also to Professor Tavakkoli Tarhi for the invitation to present in this amazing series. And of course, we are all friends from Chicago, so it was a pleasure to accept. But fortunately, I was also beginning a new project on this topic, so I thought it would be really the best place to kind of try out some of my ideas here. So it's wonderful to see so many distinguished colleagues and other people that I haven't met, scholars and friends as well. So thank you all for coming. I'm going to share my screen, and we tried this before, it seemed to work. I hope you can all see the screen here. So as I said, this is part of a new project, although I presented a small part of it before at Chicago at Professor Moyet's Festschrift conference or a memorial conference. But largely it's all new material. And what I've done really is, my approach is much more straightforward today. It's a history of the book approach, because there's a lot of material that I've uncovered. But I'm very open to suggestions about, you know, what would be the best way to kind of approach this and a framework that would be more suitable than the history of the book. And a word about my title. So the word anthologies, obviously, you know, it's related to the Tazkire biographical dictionary. But I use them sort of separately, and our Tazkire scholars here today can help me with that too. I'll go into that a little later into my talk about how I distinguish between, you know, what I call traditional Tazkires and basically anthologies. Okay, so here we go. According to an old tradition, the first poet of Persian was the legendary pre-Islamic Sasanian king Behram-e-Gur, hero of Nizami's romance Haft-Pekar, and following him of Amir Khusro's Hasht-Behesht. This is somewhat surprising, of course, because, you know, there was no new Persian in the Sasanian times, but that fact should not bother us. I believe this was mentioned first by Aufi, author of the earliest biographical dictionary, Lubabul al-Bab, in the 13th century. And then in the 15th century, the Timurid author, Dawlat Shah, in his Tazkire, Tazkiratu Shuara, he mentions this fact again, but he adds a narrative to this story. So whereas Aufi had said that Behram Gur uttered one line of Persian poetry, and that's the earliest Persian poetry we have, what Dawlat Shah says is that Behram Gur was out on a hunt. Let's see, my moving forward. Yes, here's a painting of the scene. Behram Gur is out on a hunt with his beloved Dilaram, the harpist. This is when he's said to have uttered this line. Except in Dawlat Shah's version, Behram Gur utters the first hemistich and says, Manam on pile damon o manam on shire yale. I am that raging elephant, I am that attacking lion. And to which Dilaram, the harpist, responds, Nami Behram Torah o pederat Bujabele. Your name is Behram and your father is Bujabele. In the 19th century, a new tradition arose, which claimed that this was the earliest verse by a Persian woman. And of course, I mentioned the historical anachronism, because this was much before New Persian was around. But later I will, in my talk, I will identify the sources that that where this story begins, that the very first female Persian poet is Dilaram-e Changi. There's a long tradition of making place for female poets in the history of Persian literature in the pre-modern period, despite the small corpus of poems compared to male poets. There were efforts from a very early date to preserve and read these works. Verses by women are found in a number of medieval and early modern sources, mainly anthologies and biographical dictionaries. Many of the earliest women poets are only identified by their patronymic monikers, for instance, names such as Dokhtar-e Hussam, Hussam Salar, Dokhtar-e Hakim Gav, Dokhtar-e Sati, Dokhtar-e Sijistaniye, Dokhtar-e Kashgari, and Bintun Najjariye. The earliest complete divan of a female poet that has come down to us is that of Jahan Malik Khatun, of course, who was a contemporary of Hafez in the 14th century. And my colleagues, Dominic Brookshaw and Domenico Ingenito, have worked on this poet, on Jahan Malik. There was especially a great interest on the part of Safavid and Mughal men of letters to inscribe the lives and poetry of female poets within the narrative of a larger literary tradition, and not necessarily as a niche phenomenon. Fakhri Heravi, a Safavid man of letters who ended up at the court in early 16th century in Sindh, compiled the first small tazkira of women poets, the Jawahir ul Ajaib. And we can call it the earliest biographical dictionary that is exclusively on women poets. And the French scholar Maria Juppa has written a very detailed article on this. The small group of poets in this anthology, in Fakhri's 16th century anthology, are mainly royal Timurid women, but among whom is the rather elusive poet Mahsati. And I think some of my colleagues know I have an interest in the works and the tradition of Mahsati. And I'll talk about this painting a little later, but this is, like Dilaram, she's shown as a musician here. Even by the early modern period, that is by, you know, in the sort of high Safavid and Mughal period, a substantial number of verses by women poets had been lost. But works like Taqi O'Hadi's biographical dictionary, Arafatul Ashikin, includes quite a few women poets. And this was followed by a number of other works in the 18th and 19th century. And we see that over time, the number of women poets included in sort of the larger biographical dictionaries, they increase. And we still don't have, there was only this one exclusively female tazkire. That doesn't again happen till the 19th century. Today, I will focus on the 19th century when several overlapping textual practices coexisted. Some old, such as the compiling of biographical dictionaries that I mentioned briefly, but also composition of romances on some of these poets, and new trends such as printing, even as the number of women poets multiplied. My broader interest in this topic is how the Persian literary past and the place of female poets was conceptualized in different parts of the Persianate world, specifically among compilers of anthologies in Iran and India. And I will begin with looking at the earliest 19th century materials, or at least one work, which is the earliest, was produced in Iran. But these are the four major works from Iran in the 19th century. They're all basically, as I indicate, tazkires. A couple of them were published, and the last one is a very interesting work. I'll talk about it a little later in my paper. But for the first work, the Nokle Majlis, this was a pioneering biographical dictionary come anthology on female poets from the early 19th century, written by a Qajar prince, Mahmud Mirza, who was the 15th son of Fat Ali Shah. And again, Dominic Brookshaw has published a detailed and learned study of this tazkira. It's a small work. It's been published in Iran recently. Only about 20 or so poets. My discussion here owes a great deal to Brookshaw's scholarship. He rightly suggests that Zia Saltaneh, Mahmud Mirza's full sister, should be credited with her contribution to the work, and her role as patron and co-compiler cannot be overestimated. And I'm not going to do this for every work, but this work I found so interesting. I wanted to show you how it's broken down, even though it's so small, using the tabakat kind of classification. And the first section, because this was written in a royal court, is about the Shahzadegan, seven daughters of Fath Ali Shah, one granddaughter, one wife, one daughter-in-law, and kind of Mahfi, the Mughal princess, Zibun Nisa. She's in this group, even though she's not Qajar, but she's a princess. And then the second section is this Ahvalo Ash'are Pardegione Haram Saray Shahanshah, three wives and two daughters-in-law of Fath Ali Shah. And the third section is on that Aqwalo Abiyat Shuaray Nisfan ke dar Belad Iran Budan Bahastan. So both a few poets, representative poets from the past and from the present, from especially someone like Rashe, the daughter of the Bazgash poet Hatif, a very important poet that, who's been kind of rediscovered now. And then the last section, which I found very interesting, he calls it the Majlis-e-Taze, Abiyat o Ahvalat-e Khairiyat Dalalat-e Mozunan-e Niswan. And I, you know, and Dominic, you know, wrote about this, saying that this section represents the poets of the larger Persianate world. But I felt there was something else going on here as well. And if you look carefully, it's really talking about the coquettes or the bad girls of Persian poetry. And for each of these poets who are, you find that the author, either by innuendo or directly, says that you know, they've led somewhat of a colorful life. So one of them is a motribe or khunyagar, a minstrel. Another one, Mehri, who's, you know, very well known Timurid poet, that she was involved in a sexual relationship with the niece of Goharshad Begum, and was imprisoned. And names like, you know, Ismat. He says about Ismat that tariq ashiki o dilnabazi khud ra be dokhtar qazi budan razi nemidanest, that she was not satisfied with being a lover as the daughter of a qazi. So and interestingly, someone like Noorjahan Begum, the Mughal queen, the wife of the emperor Jahangir, she finds herself in this list, you know, in this group of bad girls, is because she kind of wormed her way into a marriage with the emperor, and you know, the author suggests that she had her husband killed. So this is a very, you know, kind of on the first, you know, on the sort of surface, you get this idea that there are all these respectable Qajar princesses and royal women included here, but then you have this, you know, very interesting last bit as well, which is important for the point I make later on, because here notice that it's a separate section, and these kinds of women will then be, you know, blended into one group later on. A couple of points that Brookshaw makes in his article, you know, that I find that, you know, they have helped me to think about what happens in the 19th century. So I'm just going to quote two short quotations from him. One is, he says that the fact that only a few manuscript copies of this work, Nokle Majlis, have survived, and the fact that the work was never printed in the 19th century should not be presented as solid evidence that the work was intended for a private royal audience or one limited to a select elite female readership. So this kind of starts us thinking on the idea of readership, that even when works were written in smaller circles, royal circles, you know, they were circulated, or they circulated in possibly in larger groups, and were they written as kind of models for female poets? That's a very good question that he asks too. And the other point he makes, and to quote him again, is that anxieties concerning women's writing of any kind, and more specifically sensitivities around the dissemination of that writing, should neither be ignored nor underestimated, since women's writing was seen by many as the unwelcome intrusion of the female voice into the public sphere. By the end of the 19th century, social movements such as the issue of women's education and lithographic printing of books would result in a wider circulation of books and a less conservative view about the reading of poetry and the writing of poetry by women than reflected in this work, Nokle Majlis. Almost half a century later, after this work was written, So going back to my list here, the second work here, the Majma of Fusaha, was written by Reza Koli Khan Hidayat, who was a Qajar polymath, man of letters. Think needs no introduction in this company. And he was at work on this monumental Tazkira for a long time. So it was only published, it was actually one of the first published ones in 1871, but he was working on it for a long time. And it includes, it has 876 poets, and out of these only three women poets, two classical poets, Rabia or Rabi'e and Masati, and one contemporary poet, Masture Kurdistani or Masture Kurdi. Even for him, for Hidayat writing in the 19th century, the two classical poets were at best shadowy figures, more the stuff of legend, who could not even be pinned down to a specific time and place. Yet for many people in Persianate societies, they were real people and have a central position in the cultural memory of Persianate societies. And for these three poets, it's interesting that we have kind of, in terms of material culture, memorials. So Rabia's memorial in Balkh, and I believe Professor Shams mentioned in her talk a couple of weeks ago that she's visited the graveside. I have not. And then the statue of Masati in Ganja in Azerbaijan, and then the statue of Masture Kordi in Sanandaj, which I've also not been to Sanandaj, but maybe one could make a pilgrimage of these places, of sites associated with women poets. So the lives of the two classical poets, Masati and Rabia, as I said, are shrouded in mystery. And interestingly, both were mythologized much earlier in the 12th century by the Sufi poet Fariduddin Attar in his Masnavi Elahé Name. In the 15th century, Masati was described by Dolat Shah, the same man who, had the story about Dilaram uttering that hemistich. Dolat Shah calls Masati the beloved of the Sultan and elegant lady of the times. Mahbubeyi Sultan wa Zarifeyi Ruzagar. The representation of her as a female poet was also shaped in a popular romance dealing with her love for Amir Ahmad, or Pure Khatib, the son of a preacher named Khatib. And this is part I presented elsewhere. And this is the picture you saw earlier. This is from the anonymous romance on Masati that was written in the 15th century in the Timurid period. The story goes that Masati is the well-educated daughter of a mufti in Khojand, whose special talent lies in impromptu versification. The townspeople disapprove of her musical abilities. Whoops, did I stop share? Yeah, that tends to happen sometimes. The townspeople disapprove of her musical abilities, but when they complain to her father, he informs them that according to her horoscope, she will become a courtesan. And so she's kind of been known as a courtesan in the Tazkire tradition and in this romance. It's a very entertaining work. It's partly in prose and poetry. It's never been translated. And this is, there are three manuscripts and actually three different versions of the work. And this is the one in the British Library, the only one that's illustrated with a few Turkmen style illustrations. So here we have, this representation of Masati. And as I said, it's anonymous, so we don't really know who wrote it, but Dolat Shah does mention some poets who may have been the authors of this version or some other version that existed. And most of the work on Masati's poetry has been, done by scholars, Fritz Meyer, the Swiss scholar Fritz Meyer. Although he did not really like this this romance on Masati, but the Dutch scholar De Bruin, he wrote that Meyer missed the point of what he took to be a frivolous story, but which is really about quote, the purification of the mystic soul through an apparent fall into sinful life. And this story is very much like the Sheikh Sanan story in Attar's Manticoteer, where here her husband gives up, being a preacher when he falls in love with her and becomes a drunk, but then reverts back to Islam and she converts at the end. So a very much a conversion story, but a very interesting work, I think. So while Masati was inscribed in the courtly poetic tradition, Rabia, variously called Rabia of Khuzdar in Balochistan, of Balkh, of Isfahan, she's considered from all these places, was appropriated by the mystical tradition. She was included in the in Aufi's Tazkir-e-Lubab ul-Bab, the earliest work, where he says she was the daughter of Ka'b. Although she was a woman, she was superior to men in accomplishments. She was proficient in both Arabic and Persian poetry, but she also used to constantly play the game of love and admired beautiful youths. So pevaste ishq bakhti va shahid bazi kardi. And among the Sufis, Abu Sa'id Abul-Khair, Attar, and Jami, who calls her Dukhtar-e-Ka'b, all have mentioned her in their works. And Jami, in his Dictionary of Mystics, Nafahatul Uns, also mentions her. And again, if you heard Professor Shams's beautiful presentation 2 weeks ago, she discussed the kind of transformation of Rabe into a Sufi poet. So, that's actually tangential to my talk today. Going back to the Qajar period and to Reza Kuli Khan Hidayat, so you don't lose the thread, we're still in Iran, because he's dealing with, he's writing only about these two classical poets, Masati and Rabi. He seems to have been more interested in Rabi for some reason, and probably drawn to them and to Rabi through Attar's work. Because in 1853, he composed, and it was published in lithograph form with illustrations, a masnavi called Golestan-e-Iram. And this is, you can find it online, it's been digitized. And I just put this together like a comic book because I didn't want to go through all the pictures separately, which I've done in a different talk. I didn't want you to miss seeing all these wonderful pictures. So basically you just go through, it's the story of, there's a Rabi is up in the tower here in the palace, and her brother Horace is the king. And this is set in Ghaznavid times. In Samanid time, because Rudaki is in the story too, the earliest, one of the early Persian poets. And she falls in love with a slave boy, Bektash. And it's the story of the illicit love of Rabi and Bektash. And that kind of witch-looking character is the nursemaid who is the go-between. It's very similar to lots of the romances, Leili Majnun and Khusro Shirin. And they both see pictures of each other. Your Bektash sees pictures of him. They then come together and, very much Qajar kind of dress. There's a, she goes into battle as well, dressed as a man, which is very interesting. This is actually to help him because he's in a battle with her brother, the king. Then there's a side story of a little kind of homoerotic sort of interlude between Horace and Bektash. And this was not there in Attar's story. This is something Hidayat added. And then because Horace is jealous of his sister's love for Bektash. So he has Bektash imprisoned and she falls sick. And here Bektash is taken to prison. She's kind of also imprisoned because she won't give up her love and her blasphemous utterings. And her kind of, veins are cut and she bleeds to death in her prison. And Bektash goes and kills Horace, the man responsible for the death of his beloved, and then stabs himself at the end. So similar to some of the classical romances, as I've said. At the end, as I said, she dies actually writing her poems in her own blood on the walls of the room where she is. It's a bath, which I found to be a startling image that symbolizes the fate of a lot of female poets in the pre-modern tradition. So these were the kind of the, you know, I wanted to mention the two major works or authors in Qajar, Iran, Mahmud Mirza's work and Hidayat's work, still very much in the traditional mode, using the tazkireh with Mahmud Mirza in the tabakat, the classification of different classes of poets, and the romance, the masnavi here that Hidayat does. And now I'd like to turn to what was happening in India at the same time, and then we'll come back to kind of bring the two traditions together. So what we see happening in North India at this time is that suddenly for the second half of the 20th century, an amazing number of, now I call these anthologies, appear. So these are really biographical dictionaries to the tazkirahs, but these are published. These are all published as small kind of little books. Many of them are rare. Some of them are rare there. And these are only the ones I've found or know about so far. I'm still collecting them. So I'm really covetous of more of these. So anything you find from the 19th century, please. And I'll explain quickly. So this is the earliest one. I'll talk about them briefly. I won't talk about each one, but the ones all in yellow were written in Persian in India. About Persian and Urdu poets. So the text is in the languages, the, you know, the biographies and the introduction are in Persian, but the poets can also have Urdu verses and Persian verses. Some are in Urdu, but they all include Persian poets. This one only Urdu poets, this one only Persian poets. It's the same author, but then he puts them together again later. And the two that are bracketed, I have not been able to find copies yet. The others I managed to find copies of so far. So this is really the heart of the new project, looking at what's happening here and then trying to see it in the context of the larger kind of phenomenon of 19th century writing in Iran and possibly in other places. I've been in discussion with Sam Hodgkin, who's here today, about what was happening in Central Asia. I still don't have a fuller picture of that. So anyway, let me talk about a little few points about some of these works, so that they're all very interesting, actually. The earliest one was this work, Baharistan in Naz, was compiled by Hakim Muhammad Fasihuddin, and his pen name of Takhalus was Ranj. And it was written in Urdu. His work was published in 1864 in Meerut, North India, at the Matba Darul Uloom. It was reprinted in 1869 by the same press with the help of Mr. George Ernest Ward, who was a local magistrate. And then a third corrected and augmented edition was published in 1882 by the Matba Osmani in Meerut as well. The last version included 174 poets, 46 Persian, 3 mixed who wrote Persian and Urdu, and 125 Urdu, the largest, number were Urdu, obviously. But again, what's interesting is that the different editions, we don't have any copies of the first edition. None of them are extant. But as each, edition goes, is published, we see that the number increases because these people are constantly, as Muhammad's research team is doing today, scouting for more and more names of female poets and their poetry. In the introduction to his later edition, the second, Ranj discusses the importance of education for humans. And he's especially impressed how even ordinary British women are literate and have a literary sensibility. Obviously, he'd like to see Indians have this. He urges his readers to recognize what the British have done to foster education in every corner of India. Therefore, he says his, and here is the title page, his tazkireh is a small contribution to the spread of education in his country. And he quotes a Persian kind of and you know a saying here. He says that khane agar kas ast yek nukte bas ast. Ranch narrates how he came about writing this anthology or compiling this anthology in his Sabab Talif. And he says that one day he was reading the poetry of Mahfi, which is, you know, was the Mughal princess Zeb-un-Nisa, although there were many Mahfis, we have to remember. And he was completely overcome by the experience. And because I know there's Urdu speakers in the audience, he says, Ji janta hai dil par kya hal guzra. He wondered whether Zeb-un-Nisa was the only superior female poet, or were there others in the tradition? This led him to go through the biographical dictionaries for verses by women, the usual ones, earlier ones. And he found dozens of fine ones, he says, but he didn't find an anthology exclusively devoted to women poets and decided to compile one. He didn't know about the Qajar one, the Nukle Majlis, obviously, also, I'll tell you in a minute. And he goes on to declare that his collection was written as a lark, he said, mazakan. And he would one day write a serious book on the topic of women's poetry. So this was just sort of something he did for a pastime or just for fun. But he never wrote that serious book. Included in the very diverse group of poets are a few of the classical poets, but interestingly, neither Masati nor Rabia. They show up later, but right now, you know, that's why he's, even though they were included in, as we know, in the pre-19th century biographical dictionaries, he doesn't have them. But he's focused more on the Urdu poets and Muslim women poets. And so there are many contemporary royal women from the Mughal and Awadh courts, but striking, and mostly princesses and begums, but strikingly also courtesans and prostitutes. And very interestingly, that, you know, and I'll mention this later, you know, about the terminology that's used in these works. His work also, interestingly, is alphabetical, so not in the tabakat genre like Nukle Majlis, so that princesses and begums are mixed with courtesans and prostitutes, all alphabetical in a very kind of democratic fashion. Now, Ranj's effective reading of poetry by women poets, the way he says that he was so overcome when he read Mahfi's poetry, is reminiscent of an earlier author. And I want to kind of jump back just to mention that, because I found this such a striking kind of thing in many of these later anthologies. And this reminded me of Wale Daghestani, an Iranian poet who in the 18th century, in his Tazkire Riyaz al-Shu'ara, he wrote, and for those who will enjoy the original, I'll just translate it here, about Masati's poetry. Remember Masati, one of the bad girls of Persian poetry. But he says, one quatrain of hers is equal to 1,000 good divans. Her quatrain had become my mantra for 6 months, to the extent that I even recited it in my sleep. And any person who was sleeping near me would hear it and be woken up. Truly, this quatrain is one of those poems that a poet such as Khagani may perhaps have composed something like it once in a lifetime. And the sincerity of these words will be clear to any poet worth his salt. And he quotes that Rubai, Man ahdeto sacht sost midanistam, bishikastane on dorost midanistam. Her dushmani a dost ki ba man kardi, آخر کردی نخست می دانستم. I considered your pact with me to be very weak and thought right to break it. All the cruelties you inflicted on me, you did after all. I wish I had known before. Wale's reading of Masati's poem seems to be a genuine response rather than being merely a performative act. And can be compared to the same, as I said, the emotion that Ranj feels when he started compiling his anthology. And there'll be one other poet I'll mention who has a similar sort of response. Going back to my list, I want to quickly mention this other poet, Durga Prasad Nadir Dahlavi. And here I see the... She joined the group here. I don't know Sandas Amer, but her MA thesis from UT Austin was very helpful to me in understanding the very confusing works of this poet Nader. He was a Nader was a very interesting character. So his work was published as a Gulshan and Naz, 1876, Persian poets. And then 2 years later, he did a work, Mirat-e Khiali, of Gulshan and Naz, of Urdu poets by the same press, the Matbaa Folk Kashi in Delhi. Then the two books, if I'm not correct, it was very confusing, were published together called Tazkirat Nisa'i Nadiri. But within that Tazkirat Nisa'i Nadiri, he renames both parts, one keeping Gulshan and Naz, but renaming the second part as Chaman and Daz. So Gulshan and Naz is on the Persian poets and Chaman and Daz is on the Persian. So, but each of these are different works basically too, and they're extant. So really very interesting. The author, Durga Prasad Nader, was from a Kayast community. That is, they were a community of Persianate Hindus who were earlier employed as munshis at royal courts. He studied at the Delhi College, became a teacher of Persian, and was an editor and bookseller in Delhi. He wrote extensively, mostly school curriculum textbooks. He had a great interest in the women's reform movement. And according to Amir, Nader was steeped in the Indo-Persian tradition, and he, quote, clearly addresses a Hindu audience. He's concerned with the lack of education among Hindu women and wants to challenge mindsets that cause low levels of education among Hindu women, not among Muslims. He almost seems to think that the Muslims have sorted out the matter of female education, end quote. So very interesting phenomenon that a Hindu poet writing in Persian and, you know, writing in Urdu about Persian and Urdu poets, about the reform of Hindu women and their education. So how Persian, you know, poetry is used in this way. I'm not keeping track of time, but I may go a little over the limit, Muhammad, but please bear with me. So among the last of these Indian, the last two, this Akhtar-e-Tab on the two Persian ones that I want to mention, 1881 and 1893, the Hadika-e-Ishrat. So the Akhtar-e-Tab on the left is this copy on Rechta, the website, that I found and did screenshots of every page because they don't let you download and then cropped it. A lot of hours have gone into collecting these anthologies, I have to let you know. But it was published in Iran recently, he also wrote Tazkir of Urdu poets, but that was not part of this, you know, in Iran, just the Persian poets. So this is a very interesting work too. This was compiled by Abul Qasim Mohtasham Shirvani, who was from a distinguished family of Indian Muslim scholars. The work was published in Bhopal by the Matbai Shah Jahani Darul Iqbal and dedicated to the ruler of Bhopal, the princely state of Bhopal, Shah Jahan Begum, who naturally had the longest entry in the Tazkira. So if your patron happens to be a poet, she gets a very long entry. I mean, I think that's fair enough. The compiler, interestingly, Akhtar-e-Tab of, Shirvani, added two names in an appendix, in a zamime, Rabi'e and Masture. Interestingly, after he became aware of them through Reza Koli Khan Hedayat's biographical dictionary that was published in Iran. So by this time, the works from Iran are being, the 19th century works are being, they're being read in India as well. And then the very last one that I think in the 19th century, there may be others I don't know, the Hadika Ishrat was compiled by Durga Prasad Mehr Sandelvi, another Persianate, a man of letters, who wrote his work for a local ruler who was, like the compiler, a Hindu and crazy about Persian poetry. Mir also confesses to having had an intensely emotional response as he read the earlier anthologies of women's poetry. He says, Goftare in ser karan ateshi dar sabr o sabatam zad o rangin edaye in taife gharatgar din o iman kalay sabr o husham ra be yagma bord. And he goes on to say that after reading their poetry, he felt like a bulbul that was all wound up, or like a chicken who had its head cut off. He was so worked up from reading this poetry. Now I'd like to go to this, it's not the last, but what I was saving, this work I mentioned earlier, much earlier, the Khairatul Hisan. And it's not a typo there. I too, the first time thought it should be Nisan or Nis, but Hisan is the plural of Hasin, I think. And this is the Persian, the title in Persian, interestingly. But the work started off as an Ottoman Turkish, a publication. So this was a very important work, and not just a biographical dictionary of poets, but a work of, called the Mashahir un-Nisa, notable women or famous women, which connects the entire kind of Perso-Islamic world. And its author, Sayyid Muhammad Zaini Effendi, we usually just call him Zaini Effendi. This was published in two volumes in 1877 and 79. Zaini Effendi had received a traditional education, and after working in state institutions in 1878, he was appointed to the Galatasaray High School as a teacher of Arabic and Islamic studies. He wrote a number of things on Arabic grammar. He was also a member of the Ministry of Education and wrote an Arabic grammar, fiqh, and works on the education of girls. The famous women in Zaini Effendi's work were not only poets, but also Muslim queens, princesses, and consorts from Andalusia, Egypt. Also, I found some Coptic women from ancient from Egypt and Iran and India. And of the two dozen or so Persian or Persianate women, we find the classical poets, the usual ones, and also other pre-Islamic royal figures, very interestingly, such as Purandokht, Dilaram Changi. And yes, this is where I think the first time is mentioned that Dilaram was the first female poet of Persian. He had read Dolat Shah's story, and even though Dolat Shah never said she's the first poet, Zaini Effendi says that, and then it's picked up by other of these anthologies. It could be someone before him. I could be mistaken on this. Also, Sher Bano, among the Iranian women, have biographies here. He often, Zaini mentions his sources, which for the Persian material, I've only looked at the Persian material, and I've been working on my baby Ottoman Turkish now to read these biographies. It's actually quite easy to read short biographies in Turkish. But he mentioned his sources, and a lot of them are the usual pre-19th century Persian biographical dictionaries. Now, his work was translated in 1887, a decade or so later, first in Iran as Khairatul Hisan, your aval, kitab Khairatul Hisan by Muhammad Hassan Khan Muqaddam Maraghi Itamad al-Sultane, also known by his earlier title Sani al-Dawla. Itamad al-Sultane was a graduate of the Darul Funun in Tehran. He was a Qajar statesman and scholar who specialized in translations from French to Persian. He was the Minister of Press and Publications. And there's a wonderful Iranica entry by Professor Amanat, you could read, Wazir-e-Intibaat, and he oversaw the production of several historical, geographical, literary, and lexicographical volumes, as well as almanacs, solnames, and biographical dictionaries. His work on famous Muslim women was not a strict translation of Zaini Effendi's work, because many of the earlier Arab, especially Coptic royal women, were replaced by Persian ones. So there are many more Persian works. And it's a massive work, about 700 pages or so. And many of these women, and as I said, not just poets, but also, you know, famous women. They were from the Qajar ruling house. Here, there is finally an attempt to come up with a canon of poets, if we can say that there was one, or I think there is one now. And Rabia, Mahsati, Jahan Malik Khatun, Makhfi are all included. And he's not trying to be entirely inclusive, meaning just grab every woman poet with one line of poetry. That's what a lot of the anthologists did in India. Now the Indian edition, so there were these three versions of this work with the same name, Khairatul Hisan, was published a couple of years later after Iran in Bhopal, where the earlier Tazkire published, the Akhtar-e-Taban, and again dedicated to the same ruler, Begum Shah Jahan, and again, many pages on an entry on her, because she was the patron. This work is quite a bit shorter than the Turkish and Iranian Persian ones. This work is in Persian, by the way. It's not in Urdu. Notable editions are entries on the earliest Urdu poet, Malika Chanda, and also a long entry on Queen Victoria, who was revered as a model for the of a female ruler. And here she is an honorary Muslim. So we see that Zaini Effendi, Etemad al-Saltaneh, and the Begum of Bhopal, as well as some of the authors of the anthologies, were all proponents of education. What they discovered, especially these two, Etemad al-Saltaneh and the Begum of Bhopal, and you know, her courtiers who put together this anthology, that you could use the shared Perso-Islamic heritage to impart lessons to women, both as providing role models of powerful women, but also making the poetry available for them. Now I'm going to hurry up a bit here. I want to give some examples of the inclusiveness in some of the 19th century sources, because many of them tried to cast as wide a net as possible. And this is from Ahmad Divan Begi Shirazi, a late Qajar 19th century Tazkire of women. He has an appendix in his Tazkire called Hadikat al-Shura of women poets. I thought this entry was really tells a lot too, that the poet is just dukhta, girl, or, you know, daughter, someone. And namo nasab o zamane shura na nevishtan, we know nothing of her name or family or her when she lived. One line of her poetry, and then in sheh rabe digari ham nisbat dadan, that this work, this line of poetry has been attributed to someone else too. So we really don't know whether it was by a woman or it was by her, but let's throw it in. There's a lot of this kind of stuff going on too. So I thought this was really kind of remarkable. Another example of inclusiveness is attributing poetry to poets, female poets that these compilers thought who should have written poetry. Even we don't think they wrote any poetry. So two examples I found was two lines of a Marsiye, an elegy composed on the death of her son, Muhammad Amin, by Zubeda Khatun, wife of the Caliph Harun al-Rashid, in a line of Persian poetry. And, you know, this is perhaps less of a historical anachronism than the Hemistich by Dilaram, but still quite remarkable nonetheless. And Anna Marie Schimmel wrote that, you know, these scholars were idiots. They didn't even know that this couldn't have been possible. Another name I thought was interesting, that suddenly the medieval, and this is for Shala Khanunjan, Razia Sultan, the queen of Delhi from the 13th century, gets poetry attributed to her, which I've never seen in any historical source before the 19th century. So Razia the poet is born here. And then in the Mughal, in the Indian anthologies, there's a host of early Mughal women who are recorded to have composed some verses. So before we just had, you know, a couple of names, but suddenly it's as if they're trying to build on the Timurid tradition too. And to have a lot, you know, a lot of Mughal women, you know, have lines of poetry attributed to them. So we find here women like Gulbadan Begum, who's known as a writer of a chronicle, but not poet, Gul Chehra or Gulrukh Begum, her sister, Salima Sultan Begum, Noor Jahan, I mentioned, Jahan Ara, and Zebun Nisa Makhfi. There's always a lot of confusion about the Makhfis in these anthologies. There were male poets who were Makhfis. There was Zebun Nisa was Makhfi. Noor Jahan supposedly used the Takhallus Makhfi as well. Okay, now I will, one more point and then my conclusion. I wanted to mention the most common terms used in the Indian anthologies to refer to female poets is masturat, the veiled ones, which allows the authors to exploit the metaphor of unveiling as their poems find public readership. In a shift from the attitude in the early 19th century, when royal women and those of dubious reputation were separated, as we saw in the Nokle Majlis, by the end of the century, they formed a single community of poets. An author such as Mir, one of the Indian anthologists, asserts that the respectable poets, the Pardanashinane Ismatka, and the sellers of beauty, the Jilva Farushane Bazare Husno Jamal, complement each other, thus accounting for the great differences in social class and respectability among the poets included. Some of the terms used to describe the non-royal women span a wide range from Mutriba, these are mostly in the Indian works, Khunyagar, Rakasa, Luli, Shahide Bazar, Tawaif, Kaspi, Randi, Badkara, Khiyabaniyai. This social inclusiveness also allowed for the occasional Hindu, Christian, and Armenian Jewish women poets in India to find a place in the company of more canonical poets. In fact, Anna Marie Schimmel noted that the vernacular Urdu was largely the domain of courtesans versus Persian, which was the language used by royal women in India. While in the text from Iran, the meaning of Persianate is Persophone, that is poets who wrote in Persian, but not other languages of Iran. In the Indian anthologies, there were quite a few bilingual poets, albeit women who had composed a line or a poem in Persian, as well as a more substantial corpus in Urdu, not other languages other than Urdu, which of course is Persianate. Whereas in the works produced in Iran, the poems of women who wrote in languages such as Turkish or Kurdish, such as Masture, were not mentioned at all. Now for my conclusion, the 19th century witnessed the continuation of the tradition of compiling biographical dictionaries, both in the form of universal ones that encompassed classical and contemporary poetic cultures, as well as a sudden popularity of the anthology, what I call the anthology, focused on women poets and the printed anthology. An author like Reza Koli Khan Hidayat was somewhat anomalous, composing a romantic masnavi centered around the life of the poet Rabi'a, whom he included among three female poets in his biographical dictionary. Henceforth, Rabi'a was not exclusively relegated to the mystical tradition and became an important name in the canon of female poets. The aesthetic and effective appreciation of certain poets, such as Masati and Makhfi, inflamed male men of letters to document more such lives and poems. This impulse intersected with the various reformist movements sweeping the Islamic world, in whose agenda the education of women was given a priority. Throughout the different works, the idea of an inclusive canon, not limited to Qajar Iran or Muslim India, was attractive to many compilers of the biographical dictionaries and anthologies. But how this precisely translated into narrating the literary history of the past differed on this point in Iran and India. The question about the audience for the printed anthology is a thorny one due to the various factors that played a part in the 19th century. As lithographic printing replaced manuscripts, there were obviously more copies of works that could be circulated. The attention to an increase in female education also meant that more women, other than the elite royals, as we saw with the Qajar anthology at the beginning of the century, were reading these works. But to be honest, there is no solid evidence for who was reading these printed anthologies. What is more certain is that there was an increased deal of intertextuality at play by the end of the 19th century, where compilers of anthologies knew about each other's works. Printed books from Iran, such as the biographical dictionaries Majma'ul Fusaha of Hidayat and the Khiratul Hisan, circulated in India and were used by compilers, although this is not necessarily true of collections of contemporary poetry and other literary works, that a lot of Qajar literature was not known in India in the 19th century. So it is interesting that some of this is being read. Almost half a century would pass, interestingly, until the middle of the 20th century, when there would be a renewed interest in compiling anthologies of Persian and Persianate poetry by women and individual studies on certain women poets. And I'm not looking into these yet, but just to show you, amazingly, in the 1950s, three works appeared. One in India, this is a famous Four Eminent Poets of Iran, but includes lots of others. This is Professor Tavakoli kindly shared this with me, an Afghan work. And then this other work appeared in Tehran in the mid 50s. So in the 50s, there's an increase, again, this sort of the modern tazkira, if you want to call it, anthology, takes on a new life. By this time, most of the names of poets and their lives found in the 19th century works would be either forgotten or only of an academic interest to scholars, albeit an obsessive one for some of us. Interestingly, in the 20th century, the 21st century, as recently 2010 in India, again, you know, from the name, a Hindu man, what's the interest? Very Persianate anthology of poets, of women poets from Iran, but also of poets Afghan, Uzbek, Tajik. So this is still going on, this interest in these anthologies. And I will end with Dick Davis's words in his beautiful anthology and translation that has appeared in recent times, A Mirror of My Heart, A Thousand Years of Persian Poetry, where what he says about contemporary Persian poets can be applied to poets of the pre-modern period, which is, as time has not yet begun its winnowing process on the work of poets, choosing whose work is likely to continue to be valued is at best something of a guessing game. It may be equally applicable, and this, as I said, may be equally applicable to pre-modern poets as well. Thank you for your patience, and I would love to hear your responses.